Welcome everyone. I'm very excited to be here today to talk about what we do with Soda. My name is Colin. I'm one of the co-founders of Soda. The other one is just walking in over there. I'm just going to explain a little bit of what we do with Soda, but I'm mostly going to focus on one project that we are involved in, and that's with the ocean cleanup, automated river plastic quantification with deep learning. So just a little bit context about us. Our mission is to enable social organizations to leverage the power of data science. And we exist now for 2 years, and we've already been working together with a lot of cool organizations, for example, with Terra's Home, with the AIDS Foundation, with some governmental organizations. But today I'm mostly focusing on the ocean cleanup. We're still a small organization. We started 2 years ago, two founders and two employees, so we're four now. If you want to have some more information about what we do, feel free to check our website or follow us on LinkedIn. Today I'm just talking about one project, but we have quite some exciting projects, and we are posting about that over there. Maybe interesting to mention is that we're part of the JETS community. I'm not sure if everyone has heard of it, but it started 3-4 years ago. Eindhoven and Tilburg University decided to start a data science campus together in Den Bosch, which is JETS. We already graduated from the master program there, but now we are still involved through the JETS Playground program, which is an initiative to connect all the startups that arise in data science. But let's get to the problem at hand. As all of you probably know, the situation with plastic nowadays, plastic pollution, is quite a serious threat to the environment, actually to human health as well, especially in the long term. A lot of plastic is being discarded everywhere, especially in the more lower income countries. People live alongside rivers. And the plastic just gets discarded into the river and it flows into the ocean. A lot of it just drifts to the middle of the ocean and stays there until it gets degraded to a minimal size or gets consumed by an animal, and then the animal dies or just strands on the beach, which is all not very ideal. And if that doesn't convince you that this is a serious problem, then also the economic problem is quite big. It's expected that around 19 billion in costs are incurred because of this plastic pollution. So it's expected that 80% of the plastic pollution in the oceans derives from rivers, and that's also what I'm focusing on today. For those of you who know the ocean cleanup might have heard of this new invention, the Interceptor. They launched this. This doesn't connect well. Hope that sticks. So they launched that a few months ago, which is a solution to get plastic out of rivers, which is very important because if you get it out of the river because before it gets into the ocean, you prevent a lot of damage. But today we're looking at a slightly different problem, and that's the quantification of how much plastic is in rivers. There's a lot of knowledge developed already in the past years, but exactly how and when and where the plastics move through rivers is largely still unknown. So there are already some solutions for quantifying the plastics in rivers. On the one hand, we have computational models, which are based on a lot of secondary data sets, such as waste management or wealth in a country, or how many people live alongside rivers. And this gives quite a lot of insight already. It gives you, for example, how much ton is probably flowing through one river into the ocean a year. But it doesn't give you the detailed insight that you know that you need to have in order to actually effectively mitigate the problem. On the other hand, you have the more manual solutions, such as standing on the bridge and counting with a clicker, or throwing in nets and collecting plastics so you know what kind of debris is in the river, but as you might understand, this is not very scalable. It's very difficult to do this for long term. It's also very difficult to do this in multiple rivers, and we're talking about hundreds of rivers that are like polluting a lot. So the idea that the Ocean Cleanup had before we were involved was, can we use cameras for this solution? Can we put cameras in certain locations to monitor plastics and to offer us a scalable and reliable solution for this quantification? So they started experimenting with these cameras. They got some security cameras which they just took off the shelf and mounted them on bridges in Jakarta and collected imagery for about 2 weeks, which looks a bit like this. So you have the image and there's a lot of plastic in there. But they soon realized that it was quite difficult to actually extract the information that you need to make decisions on. So you have the image, but an image is just a bunch of pixels, basically. You need to have an algorithm that extracts how much plastic is in the image, because you don't want to do that manually, but then you're still not making that much gain. So that's why I came in. I was at that point looking for a thesis, and I decided to write the Ocean Cleanup because I've already been following them for a while. And I started, and we sort of phrased this this topic, river plastic quantification with object detection neural networks. That was then my thesis, which I thought was very exciting. Just to avoid any confusion, so I started this as my thesis, but at the side I already was starting SODA, and along the way, when I was finished with my thesis, we decided to continue collaboration and development of the solution as a partnership between SODA and the Ocean Cleanup. So that's somewhere in my presentation, there's a shift from thesis towards a more professional partnership. So the question was, in the beginning, can we use deep learning for this problem? Well, I was very excited at the beginning. I had some deep learning courses, and you always hear about everything that's possible with deep learning. Everyone says that everything is possible. Well, I'm a bit more skeptical. I was very excited. I was quite convinced that we could do something. But mostly, yeah, I thought, okay, let's just dive in and we see what's going to happen. But when you start with such a thing, you're actually overwhelmed by everything that's happening in this world. So you start doing research, you read a lot of papers, and everybody has some different kind of algorithms. You're trying to structure when what happens and which solutions extend to which algorithms. There's so much going on, and you have a lot of different types of computer vision as well. So you have image classification, you have object detection, segmentation, all these different things. And at some point, I thought, okay, I can keep reading about this for years probably, and there are still people who know more about it than me. So I just thought after 1 or 2 months, maybe I should just get started. And that's what I did. I started looking around instead of only more exploration of all the theory that's available. How can I actually use the data and create a solution? So in order to do that, you of course need data. We had the images, but images are not enough to tell a computer what to learn. But luckily, a few months before that, there was already a hackathon organized by Microsoft, and they labeled quite a bit of data. Not that much, but enough for me to get started. So that was really useful. But then there's a lot of decisions to make. What do you want to use? And I heard a lot of good stories about the TensorFlow object detection API. I'm very happy with it. I can definitely recommend it. It's basically an open source framework built on top of TensorFlow. It makes it quite easy to construct, train, and deploy object detection models. You still have to do a lot yourself, of course, and you have to make a lot of decisions. But it's easier compared to when you have to write your whole algorithm, of course. But then you still have to make a lot of decisions on what kind of algorithms you want to use or what kind of hyperparameters. But the first thing that I thought of, what I heard was really valuable, is transfer learning. And transfer learning is using a pre-trained model trained on another problem and take it to your problem and learn from what has already been taught, sort of. But at first I thought, how can this possibly be valuable to my problem? Like, I didn't think there was any model already trained on detecting plastic in rivers. And this was also not the case. I didn't see any of these models. So I was a bit skeptical. Can we really use transfer learning? But then I learned that actually you don't need to have a model that's trained on something similar, because there's already, in computer vision, there are already so many tasks that a computer can learn from a totally different problem, so many features, that it doesn't need to be very similar. So even like detecting just edges or lines or a difference between an object and a background, you can already learn that for something which is totally different from the problem that you're actually looking at. And that's why, how eventually I ended up using at first the PETS data set and then eventually also the COCO data set, which doesn't have anything to do with plastics, but it works quite well, so that's nice. So then I had to look at all the algorithms available, and that was, for me, I tried to order it a little bit, what you can use, and I saw on the one end, you saw a lot of high efficiency models, which were focusing on real-time processing, and on the other hand, you had the more high accuracy models. We had already decided that we were not interested in real-time monitoring. For us, it was sufficient to have like a few images processed every 15 minutes, because it's, yeah, you don't really need to be that precise if you want to monitor rivers. So every 15 minutes was enough. And that's why I decided to go for the more high accuracy model, like fast RCNN. Basically how that works is that it basically works in two stages. In the first stage, there's a region proposal network that suggests regions of interest. So regions which might contain an object. And in the second stage, the network classifies whether the objects are actually the class that you're looking for. So I use fast RCNN, and at this point I already learned so much. Like at first I did a lot of theory, like literature study, but then when I decided to actually just get started, I learned so much more. And the first thing that I learned is that you don't want to train locally on such a problem. Even if you have just 3,000 objects, it takes like 10 to 15 hours to train your network. And if you want to do a lot of hyperparameter tuning, a lot of experimentation, then that's not very nice. So, but luckily, we have got a nice partnership together with AI for Earth from Microsoft, and we could use free processing in Azure. So that helped me really to get from 15 hours for one model to like 1.5 hours. So a lot of efficiency gain there. I noticed that at first I was training to detect both plastic as well as organics, because we also wanted to sort of detect the ratio between these two. I found that we were doing quite well on plastics already in the beginning, but organics was really challenging, and decided to eventually drop the organics because we should mostly focus on plastics anyway. But I think organic was just too variable. Like plastic is already quite variable in shape and context, but in shape and yeah, size and ever. But organics are totally crazy. But I also noticed that I just didn't have enough data. I had enough for the first experimentation, but I needed more if I really wanted to have a proof of concept. And why is this so important? Well, if you know how neural networks learn to do a task, computer systems, well, neural networks are basically just computer systems which learn to perform a task based on examples. And if it hasn't seen enough examples, it just won't be able to do the task as well as you hope. So we decided to do some more labeling. As I said, if you just show the computer an image, it doesn't know what to do. So we organized at the Ocean Cleanup a nice pizza and beer labeling session. About 20 people attended. And it was a lot of fun, actually. So where labeling by yourself on your, is a very tedious job. But if you have a bunch of colleagues helping you out, then it's a lot of fun. So we got like 10,000 objects in a few hours, which was pretty cool. And basically, if you don't know what data labeling means in this context, it basically just means getting a picture and drawing boxes around objects that you're interested in. So one thing I can recommend if you're ever looking into doing such a thing is making use of Suniverse. It's a very nice tool for data labeling. I can definitely recommend it. But then the question is, when is the data set actually large enough? Well, you can, of course, keep investing in more and more data, but eventually, like, eventually the pizza and beer sessions won't, like, it won't be fun forever. At some point, you must have enough data. And that's why I started experimenting with that. So the first experiment I really did was the data set size, what is the potential? And these are the results. So I divided my data set into 5 chunks. And then I started with 1 chunk, which was just 2,000 objects, and trained the model on that. And then I got an average precision of 49%. And then I incrementally added a chunk of 2,000 until I got to 10,000, which was the total data set that I had. And you see that from 2 to 4,000, there's really a big jump from of 3.6% average precision. But in the later steps, so from 8 to 10,000, the jump is only 1.5%. So that's very interesting because you see there's already some, the gain of adding 2,000 objects is already going down even when you just have 10,000 objects, which doesn't sound like that much. So that was very interesting for me because if you extrapolate that, I could find that if you would double the amount of data, there would only be some percent of average precision gain over there. So I decided that for me this was enough data. So then you, of course, look into what you can do to optimize your model. I did a bunch of things, but the main thing that I want to present is the following. Data augmentation, simply because it's so intuitive, it just makes sense that it works. Data augmentation is, instead of showing your computer just the image the way it is, you manipulate it in some ways, such that for the computer, it seems like a new object. So if you have an object, for us it makes a lot of sense that if you have this bottle, then you also recognize it when it's like this or like that. But a computer doesn't work that way. But if you show the image also in different ways, you basically enrich your data set. And why that works is because convolutional neural networks make use of convolution, which basically filters, which surfaces certain characteristics of an image. And the more images you have, the more features can be extracted, and the smarter the system that you have basically is. So what is the gain that I got from that? So I started with the 10,000 objects with 59% precision, and then I did the data augmentation and got to 63%, so that's quite a jump. Then I also decided to use a different optimization function, Adam instead of stochastic gradient descent with momentum, and that again gave me 2.7% extra. And then I decided to also do learning rate decay instead of a fixed learning rate, and then eventually got to 68% precision, which was sort of my final performance of the model. I can imagine that you think, okay, 68%, what does that mean? Well, it basically means now that if we get a new video or image, we can process it through our model, and then the result is this. So you see that in this video, there's a lot of plastic flowing through the river, and the model is actually able to detect most of the plastics that are in this river. And that's, I think, very exciting to have that result. You see that for some, it's also showing the confidence of the model, of the objects being plastic. And you see that some of the smaller ones are a bit less certain, but most of the big ones are doing quite well. But then there's still some questions to be answered. We're looking for a scalable solution. We trained and tested this now on Run River. So yeah, how scalable is it then? Difficult to say if you don't test on that. Because rivers can differ from each other quite considerably. So there are different types of organics, different types of wind, sunlight. The water color can be different, and some rivers have waves and some don't. So we had mostly data on one river, but we also had some data on 4 different rivers. So we decided to test on that. I developed the following experiment. So at first we train and test a model on the same data set, which is the first. And then we use the model trained on that one location, but test it on a different location. And then have to extend the original model with some data from the new location and see how that influences performance, and then keep doing that until you reach the maximum availability of data. And the results of that are actually quite interesting. Like if you see the dotted line, that is the baseline performance of the river of which we had the most data. On the y-axis, you see the average precision, and on the x-axis, you see the amount of data, additional data that we gave to the model for additional training from that new location. So you see that 3 out of 4 rivers are actually doing quite well, despite being using a model trained on a different river. So they go from 68% to somewhere around 50%, which is some loss, but it's not dramatic. Yeah, but for one river, there's actually quite a lot of loss. And that's actually the location in the middle where there's a lot of waves. So you can see that this is really the most different from the train location, which is the one on the left. So that's very interesting. But then you are going to think, okay, what do we need to do to get it to the same level again? And we found that even if you have just 50 objects on that new location, which is not doing very well, you already boost performance up to over 40% again. And that's, of course, not something to write home about. It's not great. But it does show that even if you have just 50 objects, you can already make a big jump. And we unfortunately didn't have more data on that location, but otherwise it will probably go further up. But then the last question that you might ask is, okay, does it outperform humans? I know it's not very scalable to put people on every bridge in the world to monitor how much plastic is there, but we need to get a performance that is sort of similar. Luckily, the team, when they put the cameras in Jakarta on these bridges, they also had people counting how much plastic was flowing by, so we could make use of that knowledge. We put this nicely in a box plot. On the left side, we see the detection model, and on the right, we see the visual counting. And on the y-axis, you see how much plastic is counted per minute per square meter. Per meter, not square meter. And that is sort of within the same ballpark. You see that the median is quite similar between the two different data collection methods, which is interesting. You only see that the top whisker of the detection model goes a bit higher, but I think I can explain why that is the case. So if you put on the x-axis the time, you can see that there's clearly some patterns going like this in the how much plastic is in the river. And what you see is when the amount of plastic is not that high, so it's like between 5 or 10 objects per meter per minute, it's still a lot of plastic, but it's manageable for a person to count, then the detection model and the human are doing quite similarly. But if it exceeds 15 objects per minute, the detection model actually detects way more than the person does. And we expect, because like this person is not just counting 1 meter, they're actually counting like 15 meters. And it just becomes very difficult for a person to count 15. Yeah, it's just difficult to count so many objects. So we actually think that the model is outperforming the human here because it's just too much to count. So that was basically the conclusion of the feasibility study. We believe that this was really a good solution, but there are still some things that you need to do before you can actually use it. One of them is the following. Like if you want to help decision makers to mitigate the plastic problem based on such a solution, and you're not going to send them videos with predictions of bounding boxes and confidence scores. This is not very useful for them. So you want to aggregate the findings and present it in a dashboard like this, where you just have some summarization. You have a nice map where you can see where the problem is the most severe, and in the plot over there you see along the cross section of the river how much plastic is in there. But before you get there, you also need to do something else, which is to set up your entire cloud architecture. I'm not going into detail, but that's something that people often don't really consider until they have to do it. And it takes quite some time to do well. So for example, for us, we had to store the images somewhere, we had to process it, but we also need to compute based on a burst of images what the flow velocity is in a certain location. Because only if you have the flow velocity, you can compare locations to each other. And that's everything that you need to do somewhere in the cloud. So just something about the hardware. I didn't do anything about this, but just interesting to mention, I suppose. We outsourced this. But we do have a cool camera now that we can just put somewhere on the bridge and leave there for months without touching it. It's already battle tested in rough weather. It's solar powered, so you don't have to change the battery every now and then. It has height sensors, which allows us to compute flow velocity. And it's, of course, connected to the cloud. So each 15 minutes, we generate a burst of 3 images and then send that to the cloud for processing. So what are the steps in the near future? There's 2 things. The first is science. We have the paper on this currently on the peer review. It takes a while before it gets through, but hopefully it will be there soon. And then everybody in the field of plastic pollution can refer to this and use our solution to create more knowledge about the problem. But on the other hand, there's also the support of the interceptor. So, of course, we want to get plastic out of a river. And we can use this solution to, on the one hand, test how much plastic the interceptor is getting out, which we can do by mounting 1 camera upstream of the interceptor and 1 downstream, and then we can see what the difference is in how much plastic we count. But also, in the future, once we have collected enough data, we can relate the data, the plastic catch, to, for example, the weather data, and this helps us to predict for tomorrow or the day after tomorrow how much plastic the interceptor is likely to catch. Which is very valuable information because there are some actions that you can base on this. And once you have the model, it's not limited to fixed cameras. You can also use it in different ways. So we're experimenting also with drones. Not every part of a river has a bridge. If you're looking, for example, at estuaries, which are very interesting for research, you probably need a drone. But also, Ocean Cleanup is of course also focused on the oceans. We can mount cameras on ships that are crossing the ocean, which is happening thousands of times every day. And with that, we can really map how much plastic is where in the ocean to guide interception there as well. So just some of the main lessons that I learned along the way, just to share. One thing that for me was really a good lesson is that you have to develop a solution like this along the way, iteratively. Don't expect to get a perfect solution at once. You need to really understand the problem, but also what kind of data you need and how much data, what kind of models work well, and then eventually implement it in the field, and that will give you so many new learnings already for the next iteration. And just keep on proving based on that. And also, in this field, I think data science is really awesome in that, is that nobody is alone. There's a lot of people with the same interest, but there's so many people who have already done it before you, and you can make use of that knowledge if you want to develop a solution like this. So you don't. I realized later that I didn't need to know after some months of doing literature study, that I didn't need to know everything about what is going on inside the neural network, because you can use frameworks that are built on top of all this knowledge developed by other people, and that's really cool. But what's also really cool is that if you are working on a very exciting project that is valuable to society, there's often people, communities, or programs that can help you out. So, for example, we made use of the AI for Earth program from Microsoft, and I'm pretty sure there are some tons of other programs that can help you out, if only for the processing power and maybe someone to ask questions to once in a while. So definitely make use of that. But the main conclusion, I guess, is that a lot of cool stuff can be done with data. And that's also our main vision as SODA. We really believe that by collaborating as a data science company with all these domain experts, that we can create a lot of value for them, such that they can achieve their mission in a more effective way. So if you find it cool what we do, definitely check out our website or follow us on LinkedIn or approach me later. But thank you all for your attention.